I could date you. How many of you remember the TV show MASH? This worked a minute ago, now it's not working. There. Try clicking it once, Kim. Are we locked up? I got control now. Good, thank you. For those of you who are under 40, this was a TV show that was on from 1972 to 1983. And it was every episode was about the shenanigans of a bunch of doctors at a MASH unit, which stood for Mobile Army Surgical Hospital. And it took place during the Korean War. And it was about these guys just kind of having fun, doing their best to save as many lives as possible, and at the same time, maintain their sanity. I don't know if you remember Hawkeye and Trapper down in the bottom left corner. They were probably the two silliest characters, but also the most skilled surgeons. And there's Colonel Potter up in the top. And then the infamous on the top right, remember his name?
Frank Burns.
And he was like the Pharisee. He was like the leader of the synagogue. He was all stiff and in rules and regulations. And he was just that way. He was kind of nerdy and dweeby, and he was just totally hilarious. But there was one episode where there was this conversation. Actually, it turned into an argument between the four of them because somebody had been calling headquarters and complaining about the miserable way they were conducting themselves as human beings and as doctors and as a MASH unit. Somebody was squealing on them, and they were talking, and they started focusing on guess who? Frank Burns. Come on, Frank, we know you did it. I didn't do it, he says, and it goes on and on and on until Colonel Potter just slips in, okay, why did you do it, Frank? And he said, I thought it was my political duty. At which time, Colonel Potter came back and said, I thought you said you didn't do it. I thought I did too. Busted! Well, that's almost exactly what was happening in today's gospel lesson. As Jesus had healed this woman, and the Frank Burns of the day, the leader of the synagogue, started climbing all over Jesus about not following the rules. And the rule was he was breaking the third commandment, which, if you remember, is remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. But then Jesus responded and kind of busted them. Jesus said, you hypocrites, each of you works on a Sabbath day. I mean, don't you untie your ox and your donkey from the stall on the Sabbath and lead them to water? This dear woman, clearly the daughter of Abraham, has been in bondage to slavery, bent over for 18 years. Isn't it right that she should be released on the Sabbath? Well, we're going to talk more about that later. But first, I want to help you climb into the story and kind of get an idea of the milieu in which Jesus sat at his altercation with the leader of the synagogue. Sharon was telling us in the children's sermon about being bent over. And when she was saying that, I couldn't help but think, 18 years, that's from birth until graduation from high school. That's a long, long time. But anyway, Jesus was doing what he was frequently did. He was teaching, and he did it where he frequently taught, which was in the temple. Now, we're not sure what he was talking about, but we can almost guess. Perhaps he was talking about money. The love of money is the root of all evil. Or perhaps he talked about helping. Whatever you do for the least of these, you do it for me. Or perhaps he was talking about warning about the evils in the world. He said, beware of the devil who roars and runs around like a roaring lion, seeking who he could be devoured. Or maybe even more appropriately, maybe he was teaching them about the Sabbath. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. That'd be pretty apropos considering what happens later in the incident. Well, anyway, this woman shows up, and again, she's bent over, and it says in the Bible that she was a woman who had been crippled by an evil spirit. She had been bent double for 18 years and was unable to stand up straight. Let's talk for a minute about that evil spirit thing. Now, when you first read it, you figure, okay, it was like the devil came to this woman who was probably having too much fun or enjoying life or getting too close to God, and the devil came up, jumped on her back, bent her over, and sat there for 18 years. That's what it sounds like. The spirit came in and bent her over, right? That's what it sounds like. And I thought, well, you know, they didn't really understand, like, arthritis. They didn't understand osteoporosis and those things. So maybe it was just some natural thing that happened, because it happens. A lot of people, as they age, should kind of get bent over a little bit. But, and so then I thought, well, maybe it was something else. Maybe it was more psychological, like she had been abused, or she had been put down by society, and slowly over an 18 period, the weight of what can happen to a person just kind of bent her over. She has an argument, she loses a child, or she loses a spouse, or she can, and slowly over an 18 period just got worse and worse and worse. She's bent over with grief, blame, maybe even guilt over some minor thing that happened in her young days, and others have blown completely out of proportion. Or maybe it was a spirit of depression, or a spirit of futility or despair. Well, whatever it was a spiritual thing in that it affected and was rooting her spirit, and she was quite unable to stand up straight. Somehow she came into the synagogue that day, and Jesus saw her, and she saw Jesus. Now, maybe she knew him, maybe she hadn't, but maybe she was just thinking, well, good, he's called me over, but he's just another one of those men that are seeking to oppress women and to ruin our lives in this men-only institution called a synagogue. And yet when Jesus got there, he said to her, "Woman, you are set free from your ailment." And before she could turn or smile or speak, Jesus laid his hands on her. I'm assuming it was on her back and on her neck, and it released whatever it was that was holding her bent over, and she stood up straight. And Luke says, immediately, without delay, without thought, without anything, she starts praising God for what he had done. Praise be Jesus. Hallelujah! Can you believe this? And here I thought this was a crummy place, where men got together and complained about their wives, where the guys got together and they did nothing except make more rules and regulations to make people's lives harder and more oppressive. I thought this was just nothing at all. I thought it was just absolutely horrible. And look at me! Wow! Praise God! I can stand up straight. Now I kind of think that there was a little space between verse 13 and 14. Because before that happened, there were all sorts of other people. All other people. You can almost see the woman was going out and maybe even went outside and danced and praised, and people were coming in and they were gathering around and they were all coming in. And the leader of the Sabbath says, "No, cut out the Sabbath. No, no, this is wrong. Don't do this. Stop, stop, stop." And he kept, the tense of the Greek verb is, he kept on saying, "Not today, not today, please go away." And this is where they were busted. And Jesus says, this is from the Message, he says, "You frauds. You work on the Sabbath. You know, you work too. You work on a Saturday. And not only that, you feed your animals, you bring them to water." And I love the way the story ends in the Message. It says, when he put it that way, his critics were left looking quite silly and red-faced. And the congregation was delighted and cheered him on. And it was at this point that Jesus cleared the point of what this all means. And the point was, the Sabbath was made for people and not people for the Sabbath. That's an exact quote from the Gospel of Mark. The Sabbath was made for people, not people for the Sabbath, which means that God, when he created the whole earth and put things together, didn't set it up, Abraham, this great law that I want you to keep, but it was for the benefit of his people. I've been looking at this all week. I've been kind of looking at it because, you know, church attendance is down across America, and I'm wondering, what's going on? So I've studied reasons why people go to church, reasons why people don't go to church. I'm reading all this, trying to figure it out. And I came across this blog, and it was by a woman named Debbie McDaniel. And she wrote, and the title of this blog was Thoughts for When You Really Don't Feel Like Going to Church. You ever have a day like that? I know you do. You just don't feel like it. It reminded me of the old joke of this guy that was in bed on Sunday morning. His wife shook him and said, come on, it's time to get up. He said, oh, it's Sunday, I'm not going. No, it's, you gotta get up. He said, you go to church. No, I don't want to go. I don't feel like it. I'm tired. No, come on, you gotta go. No, I am not going to go to church today. She says, but dear, you're the pastor. We all have those days. Even pastors have those days where they don't feel like going to church. But anyway, I want to share this with you because it was just so significant. She said, it was Sunday morning a few years back, and I had this horrible headache. I really didn't feel like going to church that day. And I started thinking of all the reasons why it would be nice to stay at home. But I pressed through, I made myself get up, and I went. But I wasn't worshipful at all. And I walked in late, I sat in the back, and I took a deep breath, and my headache was better, but my heart was far, far away. And then I heard a sound in the distance off to my right. And I heard it again. And I heard it again. And I heard it again. It was constant. It was steady. And it seemed like gushing air, like a pump, or like some kind of a machine. I tried to look straight ahead. I didn't want to be rude. But finally, I couldn't stand the curiosity anymore. And I turned to my right, and I saw. The noise was coming from a backpack that was sitting next to a teenage boy. And she writes, realization swept over me as I suddenly felt my very, very trivial and my complaining about a headache. I realized what was in the backpack a few seats away. I read about this in the town paper. It was a lifeline. It was an artificial heart pumping life into this dear young man who sat in church with his family that day. She said, the rest of that service, I just fought back the tears. I was so touched by the fact that they were here, and they had millions, millions of reasons not to get up and not to come and worship. And yet, with every voice that pump made, God started moving my heart. Every breath of life gave, every gust of sound, I heard his whisper, Jesus' whisper, and the whisper came, I love you. I am with you. You are never alone. And then she responded, went on and said, the truth is, Jesus' heart does beat for us. Every moment of every day, and yet so often we don't hear it because we're too busy doing other things. We're too distracted. We're too restless. And our hearts are far away. It's absolutely amazing that somehow God knew before he started creating the entire world that somehow people were going to need to be commanded to take a day of rest. That he just knew it. And it got the thought going that God did not create the world in 6 days and then take the seventh day off because he was tired. But rather, he wanted a day where Adam and Eve could revel in and delight over the world that he had created, the world in which they found themselves. And now, thousands and thousands of years later, it's even better. Because we, in our day, we have Jesus who came and gave his life and was raised back from the dead so that we might be assured of eternity with him. He liberated us from everything that holds us back, everything that messes us up, everything, including the threat of hell itself. And he invites us to take a day. To take a day and revel in and delight over the undefeatable joy he brings to life and to eternity. That's why God gave the command for us, so that we would have a day to be together, to spend with family, to refocus and reconnect with God, who created us and who saves us. But you notice there's a lot of people that aren't going to church these days, and I talk to some of them, and I hear it. You know, like, have you ever heard the line, "I don't have to go to church, I'm a good person, I follow the Ten Commandments"? You heard everybody say that? And I am just too shy, but I always wanted to say, you're a good person, you follow the Ten Commandments. I said, that's wonderful. What's the third commandment?
Remember the Sabbath day, keep it holy.
Oh, busted. Okay. So anyway, and have you heard people say, do I have to go to church to be a Christian? Do you ever think of things that you might say? I fantasize. I'm like, wait, it's a pastor coming. Do I have to go to church to be a Christian? And the answer is no. But why wouldn't you? And so I'm going to get you involved. So I'm going to put some things up. I'll give you a hint on the first one. I'm going to ask the question, and I'm going to lead you up, and I'm going to egg you on to read the words on the screen out loud, energetically. Okay? So question is, do I have to go to church to be a Christian? The answer is, of course, no. But why wouldn't you? Why wouldn't you take? Do I have to go to church to be a Christian? No. But why wouldn't you take it an hour or two to get together with other grateful people and say thanks to God for everything? Do I have to go to church to be a Christian? No, of course not. But why wouldn't you want to gather with friends who are hurting and have the joy of reassuring them that you are by their side and that with God all things are possible? Do I have to go to church to be a Christian? Of course not. But why wouldn't you? Why don't you go to consistently remind yourself that the world does not revolve around you? Because when you think that way, not only are you miserable, not only are you miserable,
you're
miserable to be around. Number five, why wouldn't you go to support the work of the church, to feed the poor, to provide a place for groups all over the community to gather and
bring the good news of Jesus to the world?
Do I have to go to church to be a Christian? No, but why wouldn't you? Why wouldn't you go and give generously your offerings to a group
that guarantees they will further the kingdom of God?
Why wouldn't you, so that your children and grandchildren and great-children, great-grandchildren have the understanding and develop a background in
the Christian faith, which gives you hope and vision?
Why wouldn't you, when it's been statistically proven over and over again that those who go to church
tend to live longer than those who don't?
Why wouldn't you, when going to church helps you
connect to God through God and help you
Do I have to go to church to be a Christian? Of course not. But why wouldn't you, when it will help you to take your life story and bring it into the grand narrative of
the entire life.
Think about that for a minute. Why wouldn't you? Well, when you gather together for worship with others who believe, it will help you keep your entire life story, all the ups and downs, the ins and outs, and put it right there with the very Bible itself. I'll tell you what, I want you to turn somebody close to you. Somebody, if you're far away, look far. And I want you to say to them, you were not created for the Sabbath.
You were not created for the Sabbath.
And I want the other person to respond and say, the Sabbath was created for you. Okay, now I want, this is a little bit harder. I want you to give a high five to three people. Everybody, high five, three people.